Hi, good evening. Welcome to the Asian American Research Institute. My name is Nehru Chirupali, and I have great pleasure in welcoming you all to the AAARI, which was established about 5 years ago by the Board of Trustees of the City University of New York. Before I introduce the speaker of the evening, I just would like to mention to you that this will be our last speaker for this sessions. And in summer, we have the Sunset Cinema Series, which starts on July 7th and goes through August 25th. And we have about 7 sessions, and you are welcome to come watch these movies. And we will be presenting them on the 10th floor of this building. All right? And this evening's program is by Ms. Terry Axe, and I'm happy to say that she'll be talking to us about the TOEFL IBT update. And Terry is the Associate Director of TOEFL Client Relations with the Higher Education Division in Education Testing Services in Princeton, New Jersey. Terry has been with ETS for almost 18 years and began her career working with the Advanced Placement and PSAT and NMSQT programs. For the past 9 years, Terry has worked with the TOEFL program on a variety of communication and outreach activities. In this capacity, she has worked with many international education groups, including guidance counselors, overseas representatives, and educational advisors and undergraduate and graduate admissions directors. She has a vast amount of experience. And Terry is a graduate of Muhlenberg College in Allentown, Pennsylvania, and has a degree in French. And I do not understand French, but I welcome her. And elementary education. And prior to working at ETS, she was a teacher in Nova Scotia in Canada and in Pennsylvania. I hope you enjoy this evening's lecture. And I present Terry Axe.
Thank you very much. Hello, I'm Terry Axe. I want to thank the Asian Research Institute for having me here to speak to you tonight. I don't know how much all of you know about the TOEFL Internet-based test, which was introduced in 2005. So rather than give you an update on something you might not understand in the first place, I'm going to talk a little bit about what the test is and what it can do for you. For those of you that are here in the room, I do have copies of the presentation. Certainly if you are watching this on streaming video, bonsoir. Please feel free to contact us. There'll be some extra copies available if you want to pick one up at a later time. Okay.
You could be leaving some of the people here, so.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Tonight I'm going to cover a variety of topics. I'm going to give you an overview of TOEFL, the test of English as a foreign language, of the test itself, put it a little bit in context, give you some facts and figures. Then I'll be giving you an overview of the TOEFL Internet-based test. I'll go into some detail about the different test sections, reading, listening, speaking, and writing, show you a few sample questions. I'll give you the status. As I said, we've just introduced the Internet-based test in September 2005, and it's gradually sweeping the world. And talk about some of the learning resources that we have available for the exam. Before I get started, I thought I would just talk to you a little bit about ETS's mission. The mission of ETS is to help advance quality and equity in education by providing fair and valid assessments, research, and related services. Our products and services measure knowledge and skills, promote learning and performance, and support education and professional development for all people worldwide. And this was stated by our CEO, Kurt Landgraf. And I have to tell you that the TOEFL test has been in existence It is the test of English as a foreign language, as I mentioned, and it's an assessment test that measures English language proficiency of non-native speakers using an academic context, and that's very important, as I'll point out in a few minutes. It is a test that was developed in 1964, and since 1964, our mission has really been to bring learning and assessment in alignment with each other. Since our inception, we have tested over 17 million examinees. Some of you here in the audience may have taken the TOEFL test at one time or another. And if you have, you're probably most familiar with it in its original form, which was a paper and pencil test. Back before the age of computers, some of you may remember that time. Some of our younger folks may not, but it did exist. And right now, we are giving an internet-based test. We've actually tested more, we have received more than 800,000 registrations for the past year. So there's an extremely large number of examinees that take the test, all of them basically to come and study in the United States. The test is offered in more than 180 countries, and more than 6,000 agencies and institutions in 110 countries worldwide recognize the TOEFL. Actually, the number of foreign universities that offer instruction in English now require the TOEFL test. We've seen a growth in the international score user population about 25% in the last year. As I said, the TOEFL began as a paper-pencil test, and it tested listening comprehension and reading comprehension. Realizing that there are other language skills that are also important, we added a test of spoken English, or TSE, and a test of written English, between, in the 1980s. These were sort of separate components in addition to the listening and reading. In 1998, we moved forward into the computer age and we offered a computer-based test. This allowed us to introduce different types of questions that required additional skills rather than just an ABCD response. It allowed us to combine the technology with the assessment. And now we're leading the way with an internet-based test. And I'm sure all of you are aware of how important the internet has become to our daily lives. I don't think you can go a full day without hearing a commercial or an ad or even working on the internet just by virtue of your job, working with email, etc. And for some people, especially many of our younger folks, it's a primary mode of communication, text messaging, internet. Now, why do people bother to take the TOEFL test? Nobody wakes up on a Saturday morning and says, gee, today I think I'll take the TOEFL test. I have nothing to do tonight. There are a number of different reasons why people take the TOEFL. By far, the most popular reason is for admission into graduate and undergraduate schools. That is one of the reasons why we're testing English in an academic context, since that's the most widely used purpose. The top 10 native countries of test takers over the last year, generally you can see it was Korea, Japan, and the PRC, closely followed by India. And that is not a big surprise. It's a very high Asian population that takes the TOEFL test. When you compare that to the International Institute's Open Doors, they track student enrollment or students who study abroad in the United States. And when they've identified the countries where students in the United States are coming from, they've also identified India, China, Korea, and Japan as the countries that are introducing, that are having students come to the United States to study. So what that sort of supports is the fact that students coming to study in the U.S., many of them are taking the TOEFL test. The trends are very similar. Now to just talk a little bit more about the internet-based test, since that's the major topic of our discussion tonight. The TOEFL IBT measures all four skills: reading, listening, writing, and speaking. It emphasizes the ability to use English for communication, and it actually focuses on how well students can use English and not just what they know about it. And the reason that that's important is for any of you that have gone to college or remember college life or are currently in college, you know that most frequently you have a professor in front of the class who's giving a lecture or has asked you to read some text, and he may ask some questions or ask you to write a report. So you're listening or reading, and then frequently you are speaking or writing in response. That is actually using English in a productive fashion, and those are what we would call integrated tasks. And one of the innovations in the TOEFL Internet-based test is we actually use integrated tasks to indicate how well students can communicate in English. Okay, the Internet-based test, even though it's on the internet, it doesn't mean that you can sit home in your pajamas and your slippers, very comfortable drinking your Starbucks, and take the TOEFL test. No, you must go to an official secure test center. There are a number of security features in place in order to ensure that the scores will be valid and reliable. We do have about 30 or 40 test dates a year, and we offer the test at various locations throughout the world so that we can provide increased access for students. Those of you who may remember the paper-based test, it was offered once a month. So that was 12 times a year, and they were very large administrations. Now we have much more flexibility. We know that people need the flexibility to take the test a variety of times. Another big plus is that we do provide performance feedback for students on their score reports. For any student that has taken an exam and remembers getting that score in the mail and saying, well, what does it mean? You know, can I speak English? You know, what does this score mean? Did I get in? You know, how am I performing? We actually now provide some performance feedback to the students so that they know areas of strength and weakness, and then if they do need to take the test again in order to build up their score, they'll have a sense of what areas they can work on to improve their score. There is a sample of a performance feedback here, and again, I will leave any handouts here for you to take it another time. As I mentioned, there are four sections. There is reading, listening, and then a small break, speaking and writing. It's quite a long test. It's 4 hours long, and when you consider the time it takes to come into the test center and have your picture taken, we do take your picture for security purposes, and you do sign a statement so that we have your signature on file. We also check against your passport as the primary identification document we're requesting. So once you go through all those security checks and get set up at your computer, you're probably in the test center about 4.5 hours. It's what we call a linear test. And a linear test, all that means is that there is an array of questions that span the full range of difficulty, from very easy questions that the majority of test takers will be able to answer, to middle range difficulty questions that most of the test takers will be able to answer, and then the very difficult questions that will discriminate at your upper levels. So there is a full range of difficulty through the entire test. Another innovation with the internet-based test is that we are now allowing note-taking. Again, this is so that we're actually simulating an actual classroom experience. When I attended university, I was addicted to note-taking. I tried to take down every word the professor said because you never knew if it was going to show up later on a question. Not all students feel the necessity to take notes. You have the option. You don't have to take notes in order to do well on the test, but if it makes you feel more comfortable, it is available to you. Okay, because it is a new test, every time you develop something new, you need to have a scoring scale that fits the actual test. Each section has score scales from 0 to 30, and it's very easy to see how you arrive at a total score because adding the four sections together, you get a 0 to 120. Prior formats of the TOEFL test had a very complicated formula where you had to multiply and divide, and you know, it was difficult to figure out how you got to that total score, but even I understand this, and I'm not a mathematician. So another big factor that we're very proud of with our internet-based test is that the scoring is fair and objective. The reason it is fair and objective is that the test results are sent to ETS via the internet. And for the speaking section, for example, we have 3 to 6 different raters who are scoring each of the tasks, and they do not know the examinee, so there's no prejudice either for or against the examinee. Sometimes if you're in a situation where it's a one-to-one face-to-face interview, there's a rapport that you develop with the interviewer. It can be a positive rapport, it can be a negative rapport, and this way there is no built-in bias as with the person who is actually evaluating you. And for the written section, we have 2 tasks, and there are 2 raters who evaluate each written response. So the raters are hearing a range of responses. They're not hearing, someone wouldn't be grading every examinee from China, for example, or every examinee from India or the Philippines. They would be grading a variety of students, and they wouldn't know who those students are, and they're calibrated against a series of responses on a regular basis so that it is a fair and an unbiased scoring. Okay, now I'm going to go into a little bit more detail, hopefully no one's fallen asleep yet, as to the different sections of the test, and I'm going to start with the reading section. The reading section has 3 to 5 reading passages that are approximately 700 words long. This is longer than reading passages on prior TOEFL tests, but it simulates better. It better simulates what students actually have to do within a freshman class experience. Each passage is followed by 12 to 14 questions. And they include multiple choice passages, as well as different types of questions that I'll talk about in a minute. There is a glossary feature because to take the TOEFL test, it is English language proficiency. You're not expected to be an expert in any particular field. We do provide text from a variety of fields, just as you would be exposed to in a university experience. They might be humanities-based or science-based. But we do provide the glossary feature, which when you mouse over the word, it will give you the definition. And that's about 60 to 100 minutes long. There's also a review feature in case you want to go back and see, well, in case you want to skip questions and you want to go back quickly to see which ones you've skipped. Okay. The entire TOEFL internet-based test is based on a series of frameworks. TOEFL IBT has actually been, I would say, about 10 years in the making at least. There were a number of ETSers in our research department and external language experts who created a set of frameworks and worked in conjunction with universities to identify the types of tasks and the types of abilities students needed to have in order to be successful. And understanding that when you come to a university to study, it's in everyone's best interest, both the schools and the students, it's in everyone's best interest to be able to succeed. So what we were trying to do is identify the tasks that are necessary in order to be able to succeed at the university and feel comfortable and be able to participate fully. So the reading framework actually identified 2 types of tasks, purposes that are necessary, and that's reading for basic comprehension. And this was really the construct that was tested on the paper pencil TOEFL test. And also reading to learn, which is new. It's basically an expansion of the original construct and says, can I read and understand and can I apply what I've understood to answer questions? Have I actually understood it? What have I learned from it? Now, when you're looking at the reading abilities needed for basic comprehension, and these are very big words, understanding the lexical, semantic, and grammatical features of the text, and basically, do you understand the vocabulary, the meaning, and the structure? Also, do you understand on a sentence level what the passage is trying to say? And can you connect information within a sentence structure? So it's not fully developed into the whole entire reading passage. It's more looking at discrete parts of the reading passage. Reading to learn, however, requires more than the sentence level understanding. It actually requires that you process and connect information across the entire text. So in other words, you have to comprehend, where is the author going from the introduction to the conclusion? What is he trying to say as an entire textual framework? Abilities needed for reading to learn include recognizing the organization and purpose of the text and distinguishing major from minor ideas. Understanding rhetorical functions, or how persuasive the text was, what did it try to say, and developing an organized mental representation of a text. Generally speaking, in the reading domain and any of the research that's been done for reading comprehension, it says that the very best readers can, once they read a text, sort of form a mental picture in their mind of what the text is saying. You know, you start connecting ideas and you get sort of a mental image. If you're reading a novel, you know that you sort of get a mental image of what the characters are look like and sort of what they're doing. Almost create like a play in your mind. Again, once readers have that mental representation, they should be able to recognize the major ideas and understand their relative importance, recognize the organization and purpose, understand the rhetorical purpose, and remember important information. Again, remember that in all of the sections of the test, you are allowed to take notes. So as you're reading a text, you can take certain notes on major ideas so that you can remember when you have to answer the questions where certain ideas might be located. You may not need to do that, but you have the ability to do that. That is why we have those longer passages, and also new types of questions. And actually, I have a couple of examples of the new types of questions. One is a schematic table, they call it. Basically, the texts talk about opportunists and competitors within, I believe it's within the plant world. And you need to determine which of the different answer choices fit under opportunists or competitors. And you'll notice right away that there are more answer choices than bullets. So you really have to have been able to understand the text. It's more involved than guesswork. You have to have an understanding of the basic text in order to know where the different answer choices go. This particular question is also a multiple point question, which means it's worth more than 1 point, depending on whether you identify all 5 bullets, 4 bullets, or 3. This is another type of new question type called a summary. As you have read to learn, you are able to paraphrase and summarize a larger text into a few basic points. And again, you'll notice that there are more answer choices than bullet points. Okay, let's move on to the listening sections. The listening section, again, has longer, more authentic conversations and lectures. There are 4 to 6 lectures. That is the majority of what your experience is in university, as long as you remember to go to class. And 2 to 3 conversations of 2 or more speakers on campus related activities. The note-taking, again, is allowed. It is not necessary. When we looked at listening and we talked to universities and did our research, we discovered that the lectures measure the abilities needed to understand a self-contained portion of a lecture on an academic topic at the introductory college level. And that conversations measure the abilities needed to understand conversations with a specific goal that are typical of those that occur on a college campus. When we started to develop these types of tests, we actually had a researcher, Douglas Biber, who went with a group of people to 5 universities with a microphone and recorded actual lectures and actual conversations. He did not follow people into their dorm room. He went to the libraries, he went to the registrar, he went to campus student meetings in order to actually capture the actual conversation. Our original thought was that we'd put these actual lectures and actual conversations and develop the tasks directly and the questions directly from that. However, knowing that we only have a limited time to give the TOEFL test and not wanting it to be an 8 or 9 hour test, what we did was we analyzed the discourse and the parts of the discourse, and we used those functions in order to develop the tasks. So we took actual conversations, picked out how the language is being used, and used that to develop our tasks. The way this is more authentic is that you notice, even as I am standing here, I hesitate on occasion. I may say or ah, I may skip over a word. I may say, this is all natural conversation. The very best lecturers are not generally standing up there with a piece of paper sounding like a radio announcer saying, and now it is time for the TOEFL test. So it's not like your computer-generated voice that you get on an answering machine. And that's the type of language that we put on our task types. Again, it's to ensure that the students would be able to communicate, not just be able to listen, but they'd actually be able to understand and communicate. So the abilities that you're required to have within listening are basic understanding, pragmatic understanding, and connecting information. Pragmatic understanding basically involves what is the speaker's attitude, their degree of certainty, and what is the purpose of what they are saying. Basic understanding is understanding the main idea. And the important points and supporting details within the conversation. Again, pragmatic understanding is the attitude and degree of certainty and the purpose. Also, you need to be able to connect information. How is the information organized? Can you draw inferences? Frequently in conversation, you need to draw an inference as to exactly what a person is asking. Able to interpret that. And now comes the fun part, because I do have a sample conversation, and this conversation is between a professor and a student in his office.
Listen to part of a conversation between a student and a professor.
And that was the radio announcer voice.
Hi, Professor Johnson.
Hi, Anna. What can I do for you?
Remember I emailed you about getting the handouts from the class I missed the other day, and you said I could stop by and pick them up today.
Oh, that's right. You know, that's the fourth class you've missed this semester, and that's not doing your grade any good. I assume you had a good reason for being out?
I know. I really hated to miss another class, but I had the flu, and I could hardly get out of bed. That'll be the last class I miss, though, I promise.
Okay. So how are you feeling now? Are you all recovered?
Well, I'm still not quite 100%, but I'm feeling much better than I did a few days ago.
Well, that's good. Okay. Oh, yes, the handouts. There were three of them, and I'll get those for you in just a minute. They're pretty self-explanatory, but if you have any questions, just send me an email.
Okay.
But,
thank you.
Sure. But we also watched a video, and we'll be having an essay question about it on the next exam. So, do you have a VCR at home?
Actually, I don't, but I do have access to one.
Okay, well, I can lend it to you, but the only thing is you'd have to watch it tonight and get it back to me early tomorrow, because I'm going to be showing it in the other section of that class tomorrow afternoon.
That'd be great.
But you really have to get it back to me tomorrow before my class.
No problem, I can drop it off first thing in the morning if you'd like.
Okay, and you know what? How about if we do it this way? I'll keep it for now and show it in my class tomorrow, and then you can drop by here and pick it up on Friday morning and keep it for the whole weekend, and just bring it with you when you come to class next week. How does that sound? Then you'll have a couple of days to watch it, and you won't have to worry about getting it back here tomorrow.
Let's see, Friday morning. Oh yeah, that'll work.
Excellent. I'll be here from about 10 to 11:30.
Great. I'll see you then.
Oh, just a second. Let me get you those handouts.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
So you can see that the conversation is much more authentic. The student interrupts the professor goes back to repeat various ideas. Unfortunately, we are not as expert as the AAARI, and that we don't have streaming video, but perhaps sometime in the future we will. This is what you call a replay question, because you listen again to a part of the lecture and then answer the question. So it's basically you have to understand the inference. The professor will say, they'll replay the statement, this is the fourth time you've been out this semester. I assume you had a good reason. And then you have to answer, why does the professor say this? The answer is to encourage the woman to explain why she was absent. Now, any of those responses are probably, you know, possible answers, but if you understand the inference where he's asking it as a question, he really isn't expecting some sort of answer. And that's an understanding of the intonation and the speaker's purpose for asking that particular question. Okay, the speaking section. The speaking section is very exciting because the TOEFL Internet-based test is the first time that we've actually introduced speaking as a part of the TOEFL exam. Previously, it was tested separately as the test of spoken English. There are six different speaking tests. Two are what we call independent tests, where you answer questions about familiar topics. For anyone who is familiar with the TSE, it's very similar to that type of test. And then there are the four integrated questions. And as I mentioned, integrated questions are one that require to use more than one language skill. They are academic topics and campus situations. There is extended speech and a short preparation time to prepare your answers. This section, particularly, people like to be able to take notes, particularly for the integrated tasks, because you're actually combining information from something you've read and information from something you've listened to in order to be able to respond to the question. You speak into a microphone, which is calibrated to the volume of your voice at the beginning to make sure that the computer can capture your speech, which is then encrypted and sent back through our online scoring network. Okay, here is a sample of these speaking section integrated tests. First, the students would read quite a short passage. These are much shorter than our reading section texts on animal domestication. And this basically gives you the basic traits of domestication, why animals can be domesticated or not domesticated, just in general terms. Then the professor will give a short lecture, and I'm sure you're all dying to hear what he has to say about animal domestication. I know I am.
Now listen to part of a lecture on this topic in an ecology class.
So, we've been discussing the suitability of animals for domestication, particularly animals that live together in herds. Now, if we take horses, for example, in the wild, horses live in herds that consist of one male and several females and their young. When a herd moves, the dominant male leads, with the dominant female and her young immediately behind him. The dominant female and her young are then followed immediately by the second most important female and her young, and so on. This is why domesticated horses can be harnessed one after the other in a row. They're programmed to follow the lead of another horse. On top of that, you often find different herds of horses in the wild occupying overlapping areas. They don't fight off other herds that enter the same territory. But it's exactly the opposite with an animal like the antelope, which, well, antelopes are herd animals too. But unlike horses, a male antelope will fight fiercely to prevent another male from entering its territory during the breeding season. Okay? Very different from the behavior of horses. Try keeping a couple of male antelopes together in a small space and see what happens. Also, antelopes don't have a social hierarchy. They don't instinctively follow any leader. That makes it harder for humans to control their behavior.
Okay, so you read the short lecture and you've listened to the lecture, you've read the text. And the question is, the professor describes the behavior of horses and antelope in herds. Explain how their behavior is related to their suitability for domestication. So you have to remember what you've read, the general traits required for domestication, and connect that to the information in the lecture as to why the horses and the antelopes were or were not suitable for domestication. You have about 30 seconds to prepare and then 60 seconds to respond. It doesn't seem like very much time. However, basically what we're looking at are three key dimensions: delivery, language use, and topic development. We don't expect you to be able to repeat the entire lecture or necessarily to cover every single point. We're basically looking to see if your delivery is fluent and coherent. We don't expect there to be no evidence of an accent. As a matter of fact, that would be extremely surprising if that were the case. An accent would only be a problem if it actually interfered with the ability to comprehend what someone was saying. Your use of language is, do you use very, very short sentences? Can you use a compound sentence? How do you connect your ideas? Can you give a coherent response, a developed response, and can you get some of the points across that show that you do have the ability to connect the information in the text and the lecture? You are graded for each task on four different levels: good, fair, limited, and weak, and then that's converted into a scaled score of 0 to 30. The writing section. This is our other productive language skill. And again, for universities, speaking and writing are probably the two most important skills because they actually indicate how well you'll be able to communicate and how effective you'll be in the actual classroom. There are two writing assignments. Previously, the TOEFL had one writing assignment. There are now two. One is an integrated assignment, again, using more than one language skill. And the other is an independent essay that, is based on your personal experience or opinion. Typing is required. Again, when you go to the university, most frequently typing is going to be required in all of your classes. This may seem like a scary thought. However, when you look at how long the general essay is in response to one of these questions, it's only requiring you to type 10 words a minute. And even with one finger, you can probably type 10 words a minute. And I can tell you, my daughter, who uses the internet all the time, can probably type, 60 or 70 words a minute. The integrated task requires you to understand key ideas from the academic meeting and determine what information in the listening text relates in some way to the reading text. Then you organize and coherently present in a short essay, and again, it's a timed essay. It's considered a draft essay. It's not a finished product. It's not a thesis. Your grammar doesn't have to be perfect. Demonstrate basically that you can correlate and connect the ideas. And your independent task is more looking at your range of grammatical features, because this is a topic that is much more familiar to you, so you can concentrate a little bit more on the structure and the complexity of the response and the use of vocabulary. This is an example of the text that would be part of a writing sample. It's a short lecture, and even I'm not sure what it's talking about because it's very tiny up there. However, we do have then a short lecture that follows, and I'm not going to play the sample this time, even though I know you're dying to hear it because I don't want to bore you to tears. And then the prompt pops up, and you have to summarize the points made in the lecture, explaining how they cast doubts on points made in the reading. So it's basically a compare and contrast test. This is different than prompts in the speaking section in that the reading passage reappears for you to use in developing your response. Okay, for our score reporting on the writing section, again, the scaled score is 0 to 30, and for each task, you're rated as good, fair, limited, or 0. And to get a 0, basically, you have to write something that has nothing to do with the question. Like, I wish I weren't here taking this exam right now. That would get a 0. You also, for the examinees, also get, again, the performance feedback that gives them an indication of areas of strength or weakness within their writing, so that if they're having a problem, say, with a writing complex sentence or mechanics, it may point them to those types of directions. If they don't seem to be able to summarize well or get their point across, it may recommend them to work on those types of skills. Now, what is the status of TOEFL IBT? Again, I mentioned that we introduced it in September in the United States. We started in the United States. Princeton is located in the United States, and the United States has a very strong internet infrastructure, so we wanted to ensure that we had a successful rollout within the United States before we went further out into the world. Next, we introduced in Canada, France, Germany, and Italy. Again, those are very large TOEFL test-taking populations, and they have very good internet infrastructures as well. We've been rolling out across the world. Just today, we opened registration for internet-based testing in Japan, and the first exam in Japan, IBT, will be given in, I believe, on July 15th. We'll be in Korea shortly thereafter, and we'll probably be in China in September. Those, as I mentioned, are some of our highest volume test-taking countries, and China is extremely large as well. There are bandwidth issues, so we need to make sure that the infrastructure is there and available to support the test takers. Some countries will continue with TOEFL paper-based test as a supplement until the internet and electricity is available on a regular basis. In other words, there may be some countries that we will not be able to introduce TOEFL IBT. Certain countries in Africa, for example, that have a problem maintaining internet connectivity or don't necessarily have the bandwidth, or in some areas where there's political unrest that may interfere with a safe delivery of the test. We do have to be concerned about the safety of the examinees and the staff at the test centers as well. As of June 10th, relatively recently, we've had 32 successful administrations, about 96,000 registrations. Students have been testing in 85 countries, 635 cities. So it's really quite amazing when you think about the extent to which the internet-based test has been introduced around the world. I have my colleague Amber Cheng here with me, who has been one of our most successful recruiters of test centers and has been all over the world talking to different universities and partners to ask them to become part of our internet-based testing network. We now have about 1,500 active test centers and another 1,600, and those figures might actually have changed since June 10th because we're readying sites every day that will be ready to launch in a very short while. I can tell you very proudly that our test delivery and scoring technology is working well. When you're looking at a brand new test and a brand new delivery system, the delivery of the test is one of the most important things. If that doesn't work well, the whole test goes down the drain. If you can't deliver it, that's problematic. The scoring technology is also working very well. We found that the integrated test questions, the ones that combine language skills, are functioning as we expected. In other words, they are testing the abilities that we had intended. We release scores to examinees and to their chosen universities within 15 business days of the exam. That's a real breakthrough as well. First of all, to turn around scoring that quickly when you've got two sections that require human rating is pretty phenomenal. By putting the examinee scores on the web, they can actually access them on that 15th business day, and they don't have to wait for the mail to arrive at their house. Previously, they did have to wait for the mail to arrive, and if you're looking at mail in some countries, you know, it could be, well, if you're looking at mail within the United States, I guess it could be 2 or 3 weeks, but we hope not. Between September and March, the TOEFL test reliability has also been extremely good. It's well over 0.9%. We're not publishing specific data because our test-taking population, the majority of it has been in the five countries I mentioned originally, and we anticipate that some of the score ranges, certainly, some of the performance ranges will change because we've been dealing with a high level of English speaking population, but we anticipate the reliability will continue to be well over 0.9%. We have a committee of examiners, which is a collection, an external body of English language experts, who did review the test and said, and this is my one chance to toot the horn of the TOEFL program, the launch of this long-awaited test constitutes a major landmark in the history of language testing. That's a very strong statement, and we're extremely proud of that. It really is a test that will assess whether students can communicate and are ready to begin their university careers. The result of all of this is that institutions can make better admissions decisions. They can look at a person's English language proficiency and they can make choices on applicants based on that proficiency. Within a journalism program, they may determine that speaking and writing are the most important abilities, and looking at those section scores, they'll be able to pick people that are strong in speaking and writing. In some of the sciences, they may feel that the reading comprehension is more important, and they can choose students who have a high reading comprehension. So it gives a lot of flexibility and a lot of information to the universities so that they can choose the very best applicants for their programs, either undergraduate programs, graduate programs. Some undergraduate schools have intensive English programs that provide additional support to students, so they can look to see, all right, this is an area where the student needs some additional help, this is what we can provide. It also helps the students, because when they come to university, they'll be able to fully participate from the get-go. Sometimes you see students, international students, and they sit in class and they're not comfortable with the language, and they sit there and they don't talk at all. And perhaps they're not understanding what the teacher is saying, but they're too hesitant to ask a question. That doesn't only happen with international examinees. That happens with students within the United States as well. Certainly it did as I was growing up in university. You have to feel pretty well self-confident before you're going to talk to that professor. Now once you do, and you have a dialogue, things work so much better. So if you feel that you're able to communicate, you're going to be much more comfortable doing that. Then students have a positive experience and they go back to their home country. And word of mouth is amazing within the international education community. A student who's had a successful and positive experience will go back and say, you know what, you should go to CUNY because I had the best time ever. Everyone was so nice. The professors listened to me and got really involved. And word of mouth is one of the best ways to increase your international student enrollment. As I mentioned, we are not just all about testing. We have additional learning resources to help students, to help teachers, a variety of different things. There are some handouts that explain our learning resources a little bit more fully. I'll just mention a few of them. We have something called a TOEFL IBT Tips, which is it's a really nice little booklet that gives, again, some sample questions, gives the different scoring rubrics, scoring measures that the raters use to score the speaking and the writing section, provides a lot of guidance for the test, talks about the different tests that you're looking at, etc. We also have TOEFL IBT at a glance, and I don't know if this will show up on your video, but it's a lot better looking than I am. This actually explains the three different formats of the test, the paper-based, computer-based, and internet-based, so that you can see the similarities and differences. We also have an IBT sampler available online to folks who want to get a feel for what the actual questions look like. In addition to the ones I've shown here, it gives you a better flavor of the different types of tasks. And we, of course, we have a registration and information bulletin. For students and teachers, we have a TOEFL practice online. This is an actual and entire interactive test that will actually be scored. The writing section is scored by an electronic rating system, which really has a very high reliability to human raters, but because it's an electronic rating we can offer it at a lower price. The speaking section is actually rated by human raters. So you'll get the experience of the entire test, and you'll also get a score report with some descriptors, again, so that you can look at strengths and weaknesses before you even take the test. So that's an excellent learning tool. We also have an official guide that we've done in conjunction with McGraw-Hill. I'm sure most of you recognize McGraw-Hill as an educational publisher. Again, it provides sample questions, it provides responses, it's got a CD-ROM, so it's got listening comprehension. You can listen to the lectures, you can listen to the conversations, you can become familiar with the language. It gives ratings for different, at all the different levels, and then explains why it was rated the way it was, so that you can see how rating happens. And then for teachers, we have an instructional series in conjunction with North Star, which provides activities that teachers can use to supplement their English language learning, their ESL curriculum. Additional information. I'm sure a wealth of information is available on our TOEFL website, www.ets.org/TOEFL. And if there are any questions that I haven't answered for you tonight, or you just have an interest in a particular topic, there is a wealth of information, as I mentioned, on the website. There is also a contact us section where if you have a question about the TOEFL exam, you can ask the question. We, as I mentioned, have all of those test centers in our testing network, but we're also looking for additional centers. The more access we can provide for our test takers, the happier we are. You can visit us online at www.ets.org/ECEP. If you're interested in putting in an application to give the TOEFL test, I don't know how many of you are in a position to do that, but if you are, we'd love it. An application is not a commitment to give the exam, but it will get you started on the application process and it will start the conversation. You can also send us an email if you have any particular questions. And as I mentioned, my colleague Amber Cheng is here, and she is one of our recruiters, and she'll be able to answer any questions as well. Amber and I are going to leave some of our business cards here, so you can also feel free to contact us directly, and we'll make sure you get your question answered. Thank you. So I wonder, does anybody have any questions for me?
I'm sure.
I have several questions.
Okay, good. Questions just where their ability level lies, because it can zero in particular. found was that students who only got a very few questions got very upset and thought they had failed. So everybody wanted the same number of questions. So, you know, that, to some extent, that defeats the purpose of computer adaptive testing. Right. Plus the internet is the wave of the future.
So, students go to the test center and they throw the
internet? Yes, they go to a secure test center. Also, the internet-based test allowed us to capture the speech, which would have been much more difficult with computer adaptive section testing. Computer-based testing wouldn't have allowed us to provide integrated tests, because you're looking at a section of the test and you have to answer this question in order to choose the difficulty level of the next question, and so you wouldn't have been able to have the connection of the integrated tests.
So if those countries were used iBT, that means those the paper-based and the CBT are
in the first five countries where we've rolled out, US, Canada, France, Italy, and Germany, there is no computer-based testing, and we use paper-based testing on a very limited basis if needed, because a particular area can't handle the testing capacity. In other areas, as we're rolling out the internet-based test, once we've met the testing capacity in an area, there is no computer-based or paper-based testing. But while we're in the transition, until we actually have enough seats available, we are still offering computer-based and paper-based.
China
still has paper-based. China won't have internet-based until September. They're having a paper-based exam on August 19th.
I remember when I took like 4,000
years. Right.
A long time ago.
Yes, and it's very true. The paper-based test used to be offered once a month, so 12 times a year. I think in China it was a little bit more limited.
4 times a year.
Right. Right now we give the paper-based test 6 times a year.
What about after September?
After September. Okay, well, China, we're going to introduce internet-based testing in a few cities in September in order to make sure that everything is operating. Well, we're working in conjunction with NEEA, the National Education Examinations Authority. They're our partners in China and have been since we started testing in China. And they're working with us to make sure that the infrastructure is in place and everything is working as it should be. And then we'll add centers after September. So there will be paper-based testing and internet-based testing within China. Probably not in the same city, but...
Oh, okay. What city? Sorry.
I don't have a list of the cities where we're rolling out in September yet. I think we're actually in discussion with NEEA to determine which are the best cities to start with.
Okay.
They're working to get them all ready, so it's whichever ones they feel strongest about.
Anybody else has questions?
This may or may not be appropriate. How do you accommodate students who have diagnoses of learning issues?
We actually have an extremely strong program for our examinees with learning disabilities. They submit an application to take the test with special accommodations, and we adapt the test as needed. Within the internet-based test, we have certain features. If you have like a zoom lens or limited sight, different types of ways the computer can be used so that you can be able to see and take the entire exam. The 508 compliant, I think that's a ADA requirement for anything that's put up on the website. If you are blind, we have a Braille test. If you have a hearing impairment, we can do a couple of things. Perhaps they won't take that portion of the test. It depends upon the impairment and the accommodation that's required. Perhaps we'll provide the spoken section in text form, or
know, we do have those types of accommodations available. It's something that's worked out between the applicant and the accommodation that they are asking for. But for every one of our test sites within the United States, I know for sure that we have a seat designated in a special room for students who need special accommodations. Extended time, we provide extended time. So we do provide all of those different accommodations.
Any other questions?
Yes. Okay, part of that within Japan certainly is because most people are trying to take the current version of the test, the computer-based test, rather than having to take the internet-based test. It's very interesting, but anything that's brand new scares us quite a lot. I can remember when everyone went to computers and I took my first computer class, and I made the teacher promise me I wouldn't fail because I didn't even know how to turn on the computer and I was petrified. Now computers are a matter of course. But when we first introduced computer-based testing, everyone was extremely frightened and anxious and tried to rush to take the paper-based test. Now they're all rushing to take the computer-based test because they don't want to have to take the speaking measure is one part of it. And it's brand new. They don't have a lot of experience with it. And that's one of the reasons that there's been a problem within Japan. As I said, we are introducing the internet-based test in Japan. I believe that the first test will be on July 15th. It's in selected cities. I know that we're in Fukuoka and Osaka and Kyoto. And we're in Tokyo on a limited basis, but we'll be providing computer-based testing as well. So there'll be some choice for a limited period of time. Once we actually go full tilt into internet-based testing, it will be offered, as I mentioned, on discrete test dates. We offer it about 3 to 4 times a month.
Any other questions? No further questions. We want to thank Ms. Terry Axe once again. It's been a wonderful presentation. I have learned a lot just listening to her.
Thank you.
I do have lots of questions, but then I will not do it at this time. I'll talk to you separately.
Great.
Thanks again.
Thank you.